Hey there, this is Giazzo, welcome back to our channel. In case you missed our first episode, let me sum it up for you. Together with a couple of friends, I signed up to the Mongol Rally 2023, which is a non-competitive, hilarious rally where you have to drive without any kind of assistance from Europe to Mongolia with a car that is 1000cc or less. To spice things up, I decided to use a Mark 1 Ford Escort from the 1970s. It clearly needed some repairs, but it still seemed feasible. However, only after buying it, we realized that it had some major structural problems, and that is why we opted to find and buy a twin car in working order and better shape. Then we thought for a long time about what to do with the first one, and in the end we decided we will fix it anyway and do a double team for the Mongol Rally, with two identical Mark 1 Ford Escorts, and that we will repair both of them by ourselves and chronicle everything. We named the first car the Garpets, and the second one the Drebin. For more details, please check the link up here. With today, we'll start a series of videos about the repair of the cars, and we'll start with the Drebin, because it's the one in better shape and will serve as a benchmark for us to learn how to fix them both. Before proceeding, I have to make a little disclaimer. We are not professional mechanics, we are just a bunch of guys who are very passionate about this project and are doing the very best they can with their different level of mechanical knowledge, and they are literally doing this thing in their spare time and in our backyards. So please be kind with us, we may make mistakes, but we are doing everything in good faith and, as I mentioned, in the very best way we can. With that said, let's jump into it. So, how do you fix a car that's 50 and more years old and you have no clue where to start? I have to admit, we kind of cheated. It was Fede's idea because he had a brilliant intuition. This is the Harness Manual for the Ford Escort Mark 1. These technical manuals are made by enthusiasts for enthusiasts, and specifically they go into great detail in explaining not only how to properly maintain your vehicle, but also how to dismantle it completely and rebuild it from scratch. And as such, they are the go-to reference for the do-it-yourself lovers. This specific book is from 1982 and it contains everything we might need to know. And now, with the power of the Holy Highness Manual, everything was possible! And we could finally lay down our repair plan. Before we could even start, the Drebin decided by itself which were its own priorities. On a regular day, I went for a quick ride around town, then I got back home and this happened.
Sì, sa di plastica bruciata, ma viene solo da qui.
Marmitta non è. Cioè, come viene dai freni?
Qui non c'è niente.
No time to waste, I have to meet with the guys. This car sports drum brakes, the precursor of the more modern disc brakes. Some variants of the Mark 1 came with optional front disc brakes, but not this one. The Drebin has drums both on the rear axle and on the front axle. The way they work is quite simple. When you press the braking pedal, the fluid inside the hydraulic braking system activates these little pistons that will push the shoes against the inner side of the braking drum. The resulting friction will slow down the speed of the wheels and, consequently, of the whole car. When the braking pedal is released, these springs allow the shoes to go back into resting position, so that the shoes do not constantly touch the drum. For a more detailed explanation, please check the link in the description. Let's first check the drums. An easy way to do so is to mount them facing outwards and watch them spinning. As you can see, this drum is wobbling, probably due to warping secondary to overheating. Let's watch it more closely. We may have our culprit here. This deformation could be problematic because it could make the shoes touch the drum even when the brakes are not engaged, leading to increased friction.
Alcuni momenti tocca.
Bravissimo.
E vai, gira. Ok. Sì, un pochino, però. Vai.
Also, the other drums had a little bit of warping, but nothing worrisome.
però. Fede, possiamo girare?
Certo. Guardate lì dalla ruota.
Ok. Si vede che c'è quel giochino millimetrico.
We decided to change only that drum and for the moment keep all others. Then we started remounting them, which was an interesting exercise.
Caccialo anche direttamente nel cuscinetto, così.
Il grasso
non fa mai male.
We'd better be sure not to leave any bush or bolt behind, you know, for our own safety, I guess.
Occhio alla machine, sollevala un po' già su, muovilo piano piano.
Buono.
Oddly, when dismantling the brakes, we found that some parts were misaligned.
Non può essere scappata per quello, sai?
Metà dell'opera c'è.
Vedi che scappa.
No, a posto.
Bella, la derino su.
Devo essere sicuro che non interferirebbe.
After checking the drums, shoes, etc., it was now time to check the braking system itself.
Quindi questo qui è il freno. Mm-hmm. Ok, uno va davanti, uno va dietro.
This is the braking fluid we mentioned earlier. The one thing we want to check now is whether there is air in the system, because air bubbles can block the fluid from activating the brakes, and the only way to get rid of those bubbles is to bleed the system.
Sta già scolando.
Vedi che è strunza. No, ti conviene.
Sì, non gli ho dato neanche mezzo giro, eh. Tanto devo solo fare aprire il chiudi. Pompi, pompi!
Cioè spingo sul freno?
Se sì. Vuoi, sì.
Ok.
Devi fare una pressione leggera ma costante. A un certo punto sentirai che il pedale va giù, è perché sono io che apro. Okay. Devi sempre tenere la pressione, okay. Leggera ma costante.
Pompa come se la massi veramente.
Esatto.
Esce qualcosa?
Sì, sì. Già quattro bolle d'aria sono uscite. E la Madonna.
Aria.
Ne è uscita una grossa. Se dai una bella pompata forte, decisa. Ok. Stop. Pompa a fondo.
What a better way to test these brakes than go out for a field trip. Oh, and we took my dad with us for the ride.
Sì, c'è da fargli la convergenza perché riguarda il
vibro un po'.
Sì, la vibrazione basta che una
che
si stacchi un pesetto.
La macchina di questo genere qui, le vibrazioni.
What can I say? The ride was very enjoyable, and after 20 minutes or more of driving, the brakes did not overheat even once, and responded perfectly. Having checked and fixed the brakes, we moved on to another item on our checklist, which was switching from the dynamo to the alternator. But before moving on, let me introduce to you our sponsor of today, which is Motomobil. Do you also own a vintage Ford that may need some repairs here and there, but you have no idea where to find that broken or outright missing part? Look no further. Their online shop has literally anything you may need, ranging from water pumps to pistons of different sizes to bushes, gaskets, even screws. And with more than 30 years of activity on their back and a passionate attention to the customer, they are a point of reference for vintage Ford owners in Europe and beyond. Thank you Motomobil for all your help and for sponsoring this video. And now back to the Drebin. Both a dynamo and an alternator are very important in order to recharge the battery of the car. But what is the difference? Why, if we have a dynamo that is in working order, we want to switch to an alternator? Well, the answer is simple. Both generate electrical current by the spinning of wires and magnets inside them. But the spinning is provided by the revolutions of the engine, which they are connected to via belt, and only when the engine is running. The main difference is that the dynamo generates direct current and, overly simplifying, its output is directly proportional to the number of revolutions of the engine. So, if the engine is idling but a lot of electrical current is drawn by the lights, the radio, etc., the dynamo may not keep up with this electrical draw and the battery will be drained, not recharged. The alternator instead generates alternate current and its output, while being still proportional somehow to the revolutions of the engine, is sufficient to power all the main electrical appliances of the car and recharge the battery, even when the car is idling at low revolutions. So it's better to have an alternator, and it is the reason why all modern cars have one instead of a dynamo, because even when you're in a traffic jam, the battery will be recharged regardless. Some Mark 1s came with an alternator, and Rico managed to find a homemade conversion manual, which we used as a reference. First of all, we had to temporarily take down the dynamo to check its bracket and see if an alternator would fit in there.
Adesso si potrebbe, ci vuole la cinghia lunga un paio di centimetri. Adesso le tiriamo giù la strappa, prendiamo le misure della suddetta.
Spoiler, the answer is no, the bracket is specific for a dynamo and does not fit an alternator. The Highness manual would reveal that the Mark 1 Ford Escort needed a Lucas 16 ACR alternator, which of course was now out of production, but we were able to find a compatible alternative, and Fede managed to find a compatible bracket. And now it was time for the Drebin to receive a much needed upgrade.
Un uomo e una dinamo.
Un uomo e la sua
dinamo. Quindi con la piastra è giusto, sì.
Ciao ciao. Vedi che attacca anche sopra? Sì. Però noi non ce l'abbiamo. Aspetta.
La vite? Usiamo una di quelle là che. Quella che mi hai detto che avanza, no?
Che sexy. Con la piastra.
We were quite lucky to find a bracket that would allow us to keep the alternator close to the engine. We could not say the same regarding the tensioner bracket, which is needed in order to keep a correct distance from the alternator to the engine and to have the belt in tension, hence the name, for it to make the alternator spin properly. The quest for finding the tensioner bracket was so painful that we almost gave up. Then we thought, I mean, it's a sheet of metal, if it's so impossible to find, why don't we make our own? And that's what we did. I'm feeling very sorry for your ears in this moment, so have some classical music instead.
Sì, molto bene. Vallo a fine corsa.
Sì, non ci arriva a fine corsa, ma.
Però direi che molto bene.
All right, back to business now.
Passami le altre due.
But this doesn't mean we can't have some background music.
Ce l'ho. Qualche cosa. Mi sembra in asso. Allora, io adesso devo mettere questa. Aspetta, fammi vedere. Sì, dovremmo. Ok. Oh, scusa.
No, no, proprio.
Lì c'è un punto in cui.
Sì, vabbè.
With the alternator in the correct position, we now needed to hook it up to the engine using a belt.
800 non ci va molto bene, no, è un po' precisa. Riusciamo a metterla, ma non attenderla fuori dallo fuori dalla portata dello scarico, secondo me.
Così non ti piace.
3 cm, 4 cm.
Dice troppo vicina al tubo di scarico.
Dei... Si riesce a tendere bene, ma per me, visto tutto lo spazio che abbiamo,
vai, vai, ah, sì, prendiamo l'8,50.
Vai, scaravacchialo se riesci. Sì, 2 cm in più.
Più o meno, non proprio. Anzi, un po' meno. Vai.
Vabbè, però. Vedi che ci sono adesso 4 cm, quasi 5 qua. Direi, sì, che così ci siamo, no. Cosa ne dite, ragazzi?
Sì. Ah, sì, sì, sì.
Spazio ce n'è, mi sembra che sia meglio, sì, evitare fusioni. Sì, 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 sì. Stringiamo prima le viti del perno.
Se vuoi, sì.
Sì, sì.
Now we just needed to tighten the bolts to keep the alternator still.
No, la brucola la lascio da tenere a te.
Oh, and this is the voltage regulator of the dynamo, but the alternator has its own regulator, so we're gonna get rid of this properly, of course. According to that guide, we should have wired all the cables correctly. So the setup is complete, and it's now time to test it.
No, niente. Spegni. Non sta caricando.
Okay, okay, don't panic. We just messed with a couple of wires. We soldered them correctly and then we run another test.
Va bene, vadi. Un po' di gas. Sgasa, sgasa, sgasa. Vai, 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 vai. Siamo arrivati 13 volte 60, ci piacciono? 13,70. $13,75, $13,80, si è stabilizzato su $13,82. Prova a spegnere. Adesso infatti sta scendendo. Piano piano.
And this time it went as expected. With the brakes in working order and the alternator up and running, we were one step closer to have the Drebin ready for this journey. And so we thought. Actually, the Drebin, it's in own very peculiar way, reminded us that it's a very old car that needs a lot of repairs. But for more details on what happened, stay tuned for the next episode. And this is all for this episode. We hope you all enjoyed it, and if you're curious about what will happen next with our two Ford Escorts Mark 1, subscribe to our channel so not to miss any new content. We hope you had fun with us and find that these videos interesting, and we'll see you next time.